And it is in verse 37 and verse 38. The Bible says, on the last and most important day of the festival, Jesus stood up and said in a loud voice, "Whoever is thirsty, they should come to me. And whoever believes in me should drink. As the scripture says, streams of living water will flow from within them." Jesus said this about the Spirit, which those who believed in him were going to receive. Amen. You may take your seat. Church of God, how are you? Are you good?
Yes.
Are you good?
Amen.
Jesus is working.
Yes.
Jesus is working.
Yes.
Can you trust him to work?
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
The first thing I want to talk to you about is saying over here that the life-giving waters, or the living waters, will flow from within those that believe in him. Amen. And believing in him, the first thing is that we need to sit in our faith. To sit means you stop trying to do it yourself. Why do you run up and down? It's because you believe more in your own efforts. But the first thing is that we need to trust him. Yes, you will need to make a move. In faith, you must make a move. But the move is not that other move that you're going to make. Hallelujah. Do you understand me? First, sit. Amen. First sit so that God can work. First sit. First sit. First sit. Before you want to run too much, first sit and say, "Lord, I trust you." Amen. The Bible says, streams of living water will flow from within them. God's Spirit will flow through your heart when your heart is firm in him. We need a firmness in our heart in order for God to work through your heart. So the first thing is, I want you to let go of what you were trying to hold on to and give it to God.
Amen.
Let go and give it to God. Let go and give it to God. Sit. Now please don't sit just anywhere. The sitting we are talking about is not asleep. We didn't say lie down. Amen. We said sit. We didn't say lie down.
Amen.
We said sit. Sometimes you are sitting, but you are lying down. You are asleep in there. Sit to listen.
Amen.
Sit to listen. Amen.
Amen.
Sit to speak. When you have a meeting with somebody, isn't it? When you have a meeting with somebody, what do? You sit so you can talk nicely. Amen. Do you talk to people lying down? No, no, that's going to be complicated, isn't it? Do you talk to people standing up? It's going to be a different kind of conversation. Do you understand? We need to sit and pray. We need to sit and listen to God's word. We are not going to get this thing right of reading God's word unless we sit. You will always have something to do, my brother, my sister. Amen. You will always have something to run for. Life is difficult to hold in your hands. It's always running faster than you. Amen. But we need to sit at His feet. We need to sit at the right place. Do you remember Mary and Martha? Martha was busy. She was serving Jesus. She was preparing a meal for Jesus and many things. And she was complaining because Mary wasn't joining her. Now, some of you, you don't join Mary because you are lazy, not because you are sitting and listening to Jesus. May that not be your reason for sitting. Amen. That's not sitting, that's sleeping. That's lying down. It's sleeping. Sleeping, you get nothing. At least Mary will get her reward. Amen. Actually, when you are sleeping, someone will steal from you. Don't be lazy. Amen. At least join the people who are working. But Mary was doing something better. Mary was sitting in order to get what Jesus was saying. Mary wanted to know what was Jesus saying. Amen. Mary was interested. She was concerned about what is Jesus trying to tell them. Amen. Pastor Ebenezer speaks to us so many things. Amen. But I believe that I need to tell the church of God to sit and listen. You need to become concerned with what is the mind of Christ. The Bible says we have the mind of Christ. You also have the mind of Christ, but you are not sitting. The mind of Christ. Who is Christ? Christ is the anointed one. That's what Christ means. Jesus Christ is upon your pastor by the anointed. Amen. That's what Christ means. He's the anointed one. Do you understand that? Jesus says, as the Father sent me, so I'm sending you to these people. God sends you people. Amen. Amen. So what I'm saying to you is that there is a mind of Christ. There is a mind of Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. There is a mind of Christ. But we need to become like Mary and say, what is he trying to say? What is he saying? What is he saying? Amen. Today we need our minds to be renewed. Yes. Amen. You need your mind to be renewed. You need some anointing on your head. Amen. Yes. You need some anointing on your head. You need some mind renewal. Yes. You need some mind renewal. You need mind renewal. The mind of the flesh leads to death. Amen. Amen. It can be intelligent, it can be a good plan, but if it doesn't have the mind of Christ, hey, it's going to get stuck. It's going to get dry. It's going to get tired because it's empty. Amen. We need to live by the mind of Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. The Bible says, the people were they were all into their dreams and visions, but they were still disconnected from the head. Hallelujah. It means it's not enough just to be in the, even in the beginning, you're giving me a Bible verse. You can be telling me your dream. You can be telling me this or that. You can be telling me this is a wonderful song. But what is the mind of Christ? Do you understand? I'm saying to you is that Jesus Christ is speaking. Hallelujah. But we need to become concerned about what is Jesus teaching me now? Amen. Amen. That is a good question to be asking your neighbor. What is Jesus teaching you these days? What is Jesus teaching you these days? Amen. Are you sitting? Are you sitting? Amen. Are you sitting? Now I'm saying that the mind of Christ is made available to you. Now, let me tell you something. Not everyone has access to the mind of Christ. Not everyone has access to the mind of Christ like you have. No, they don't. The Bible says in those days the word of God was rare. Until Samuel heard the voice of God and began to speak. Amen. It's not because there wasn't church. There was church. Hallelujah. It wasn't because there weren't services. There were services. But the mind of Christ. Hey, JTR, you have the mind of Christ.
Yes.
You have to begin to sit. You have access to knowledge that is alive. You have access to knowledge that people look for and they don't find it. The world is dry. If the world is dry, the world is dry. Why are you admiring the world? Amen. I can admire people in the world. They are dry. Amen. The mind of Christ is the source of life. You have access to the mind of Christ. Now, let me tell you very plainly. The mind of Christ comes to us directly and indirectly. The anointing, the mind of Christ comes to you. It's called revelation. What is revelation? Revelation is when the eyes of your heart open to understand something, a knowledge that God makes you aware of. Amen. What is in your mind determines what your will is or what your decision is. What is in your mind determines what you are going to say. What is in your mind determines the way you see things affects how you interact with those things. Amen. So when you talk about the mind of Christ, you're talking about what is God seeing in your life? What is God seeing in the church? What is God seeing on this campus? It's what He's going to do about it. Hallelujah. Behind the mind of Christ is the will of God. It's His determination. If you want to encounter the determination of God, it's in the mind of Christ. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. The determination of God. The determination of God. You want one, that one. You want that one. You will never give up. You will never give up. You will never give up. There will be no closed doors before you. In the determination of God.
Amen.
You can close Jericho. I will find a way in.
Amen.
The mind of Christ. There's a determination behind it. There is a determination behind it. The Bible says, I have decided and I will not change my mind. Hallelujah. I have decided and I will not change my mind. Hallelujah. We have to become single-minded like God. God is single-minded. He is single-minded. He has made up His mind. He has made up His mind. Heaven. We need to take things like that. You know, there's something about God. Something I've seen about God. God will look at something. He won't think this or that. He will say, what is it? It's this. You'll deal with it. Amen. But for us, we're like, okay, how about this? Maybe this, maybe this, maybe this. Yes, there's a seeking so that we must know. But something I've seen about God is His mind, it's very definite. He acts on His mind. He doesn't doubt in His mind. There's no doubt in God's mind. There's no doubt in God's mind. There's no going back on God's mind. He makes a decision. He makes a commitment. It's for life. He's in it. He's in it. He's in it. Amen. He's not saying, I will do and then maybe I won't do and then. He makes up His mind. When He makes up His mind, He makes up His mind. Amen. Oh, there's something about this mind of Christ. There's no doubt in it.
Yes.
But what I'm saying to you, JTL, is that you have the mind of Christ.
Yes.
The mind of God can come to you indirectly or directly. Directly in prayer and the word. When you are in prayer, you are seeking His face. Amen.
Amen.
You are drawing near to Him.
Yes.
The Bible says, draw near to me and I will draw near to you. So He can reveal Himself to you when you seek Him. Amen.
Yes.
So it says, your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. That's Psalm 119.
Amen.
Your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. It means there is a power of revelation in the word of God. Amen.
Amen.
We need to be in the word of God. We need to be reading the word of God. We need to be praying. In that place, God can speak to you. But something I'll tell you is that God speaks in many ways. Now this way, now that way. But it's man who is not paying attention. That's what the Bible says in Job. Amen.
Amen.
Why don't we pay attention? Because we don't trust His word. Most of the time, that's the reason. Because we don't trust in Him. Most of the time, that's the reason. Because we don't trust in Him. So that's why we're very worried. We're very anxious. Because we trust in ourselves. We trust in what we know. We trust in our abilities and our strength. But I'm telling you about Jesus' word here that says, if anyone believes in me, streams of living water will flow from within them. That understanding can also flow, eh? The abilities can flow. Everything has to be sustained by the Spirit of God. So sometimes we get stuck easily because we don't trust God. Amen. We need to put our trust in God. Why don't we sit down? Why don't we sit down? Why can't you sit down? Why can't you sit down? I'll give it to you in this example. The disciples of Jesus were in a boat with Jesus, and there were storms, and there was wind, and there was waves, and then Jesus began to sleep. And they couldn't sleep. They were about to die. Amen.
Amen.
They woke up Jesus. Jesus, don't you care? They're about to die. Amen.
Amen.
But Jesus, he was sleeping, but he was sitting. He wasn't sleeping and sleeping. He was sleeping and sitting.
Yeah.
Because he had the mind of Christ. Amen. He was awakened in himself. How do I know that? Because when they woke him, he wasn't complicated. He woke up and he says, I will show you what to do. And he spoke to the wind and the wave. And he said, be silent. You can't say to the wind and the wave, be silent, if you're not sitting down on some authority. Amen. So I'm saying to you that Jesus was not running up and down when the storm was there. He said, I will sit. And when the right time comes, I will stand and I will act. Amen. I will sit. Amen. So I want to say to all, all of you experiencing some pressure and all of this, don't be jumping up and down in the boat. Don't be stressing in that boat. You need to sit. Amen. The disciples, they got one thing right. They spoke to Jesus and they said, Jesus, amen. Even when you are not sitting, at least you can speak to Jesus. Amen. Even if you are not sitting yourself, amen. If that boat is going up and down, that boat in your heart, amen. That boat of your heart is going up and down. Amen. But at least you can talk to Him. At least keep Jesus in your heart. At least keep Him in there.
Amen.
Because then He will speak for you. Amen. But we need to sit. We need to sit. JTL, there's a mind of Christ that is made so available to you. That is made so available to you. Another reason why we don't sit is that we don't value. We don't value. We don't value. We don't value. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible says, don't give a pearl to a pig who's going to them. Do what with a pearl? Throw it into the mud. Amen. Amen. We have to value the mind of Christ. You have to value. Do you know that without the mind of Christ, you are like, have you seen a body part that is disconnected from the head? It's going to be dead or alive. When you cut off your arm becomes, it becomes what? Does your head become dead or your arm become dead? Your arm becomes dead. Amen. Without the mind of Christ, that is a death. Hallelujah. We have to learn to value the mind of Christ. Amen. That's what can make us to sit. The sitting I'm talking about, it's also giving yourself. If you don't value the mind of Christ, you won't be able to give that time. You won't be able to give that attention. Amen. Sitting also requires an effort. It's a different kind of effort now. Amen. You're saying, I will take away my efforts from all of these things. I need the mind of Christ. Amen. We need to value. We need to value. We need to value. Church of God, do we value? Let me give you an example of two people. Adam and Eve. They had the mind of Christ. What was the mind of Christ? Have dominion. Hallelujah. Have dominion. Be fruitful. Multiply. Hallelujah. They had the mind of Christ. And what else was it? Eat from every tree. Because to multiply, to have dominion, they needed to interact with the garden. Amen. Eat from every tree, but do not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Amen. What did the devil do? The devil came and devalued the mind of Christ. He didn't devalue their favorite scripture. Hallelujah. He devalued their non-favorite scripture. Do you hear me? The mind of Christ is a full package. Pastor says, eat the whole chicken. Amen. If you leave some of it, you will lose all of it. They left part of the mind of Christ and they lost all of it. Amen. Jesus said this. He said, be careful of the yeast of the Pharisees. Now, what is he talking about? He was saying that the Pharisees have teaching. But in that teaching, yes, it is true. But inside there is an attitude towards God that is not true. Amen? There's a hypocrisy. There's an element of show, of the outward. Amen? The mind of Christ is not just knowledge in your head, beloved. It must be in you. It must be you. Amen. The mind of Christ is your mind. We don't accept another mind. That's the yeast of the Pharisees. They had the knowledge, but in them was another mind operating behind the scenes. Amen. Refuse any other mind but the mind of Christ. Reject every other mind but the mind of Christ. Don't listen to any other mind but the mind of Christ. Amen. People can speak. Lecturers can speak. But you need to say, is this devaluing the mind of Christ? If it's devaluing the mind of Christ, what is behind it? The serpent in the garden. What is the serpent in the garden after? What is he after? He is after devaluing the mind of Christ in your life, so that what can he do to you? So that he can kill you. Amen. So that he can take the glory of God away from you. Amen. Because the Bible says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It comes from that serpent. That was his plan. Amen. It all comes when we accept having another mind as of the mind of Christ. People, our battle on this campus, we need the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ has a knowledge, but it also has an influence. Sometimes you can know something, but you are influenced in something else. Don't all students know they must study in order to do well in their exams? Why do you find some students wasting time in things? There's an influence out there. Amen. There's an influence. It's dead. It's a dead, deadly influence. Deadly influence. You understand? So this is the serpent. He has an influence and he has a knowledge. He can have arguments and he can just have influence. Amen. So the mind of Christ, which crushes the mind of the serpent, because the seed of the woman, which is Christ, the Bible says in Galatians. Have you read that? In Galatians 5, what does it say? Well, Galatians 3. It says, the seed of the woman will crush the serpent's head. Amen. You have to crush the serpent's head if you want to keep your life in the spirit. Amen. You need to crush his head. And how does he come? He comes by making you not to sit. He kills your trust in God. He shakes your trust in God. He can do it softly. He can do it with his intelligence. Amen. But he also can influence you to devalue. To devalue the mind of Christ. You have to crush his head. Amen. You have to crush his head. Have you found that scripture? In Galatians. Where is it? It is Galatians. Galatians. Where is this good scripture? Where is this good scripture? Brother Love, are you going to find it for us and you will let us know? Amen. Amen. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. The Bible says in verse 2. I am jealous for you, just as God is. You are like a pure virgin whom I have promised in marriage to one man only, Christ himself. I am afraid that your minds will be corrupted, that you will abandon your full and pure devotion to Christ in the same way that Eve was deceived by the snake's clever lies. For you gladly tolerate anyone who comes to you and preaches a different Jesus, not the one we preached. And you accept the Spirit and the Gospel completely different from the Spirit and the Gospel you received from us. Amen. Amen. Be careful what you drink. Be careful what you eat. We are talking about what you believe, what you listen to. That's what you are eating. That's what you are drinking spiritually. Amen. What you are believing. What you are listening to. And it says, be careful. Someone else can begin to speak to you. Amen. And when they speak to you, it's not only people. It can even be your own mind over there. And you can say, ah, those people in church, they were looking at me finally today. Ah, you know. It can be things like that. I'm telling you the truth. You can have issues with your brother and your sister for nothing. For nothing. The serpent is a problem. Was there any problem between God and Adam and Eve? No problem. Bring in the serpent. Problem. Amen. Amen. Refuse thoughts. Refuse preachings of the enemy. Refuse things of the enemy. Amen. When bad feelings rise in you towards your brother and your sister, a bad vision. Amen. When there's an issue, it can be for whatever reason, whoever's fault it is, it doesn't matter. The point is that problem, there's a serpent behind it. Somewhere there's a serpent behind it. Amen. The same way it caused a problem between the relationship between God and Adam and Eve is the same way it will cause problems between you and your leader, you and your brother, you and your sister. Yes. It's a serpent. Crush the serpent's head. Yes. Hallelujah. Amen. Because issues just lead to death. Do you agree? They lead to death. If you keep it, you are going to keep your death. Yeah. Let's go in Jesus' name. Yes. Say, Lord, crush the serpent's head. Amen. Crush the serpent's head. Yes, I can think and think and think. Don't think too much. Think less, pray more. When the serpent is around, think less, pray more. He's very intelligent. The Bible says the serpent in Revelation 14, Revelation 12, the serpent has seven heads. What does it mean? You can think this way, you will have something to say to you. You can think from that angle, you will have something to say to you. Don't think too much. Pray. Crush his head. Crush his head. Crush his head. Crush his head. Until one mind. One mind. And you know, this is Jesus. The Bible says, my sheep know my voice. The Bible says we have the mind of Christ. What does it mean? It means if you sit, you crush the serpent's head, you as a child of God, you can begin to know what is the mind of Christ. But you have to value the sources of the mind of Christ. If you don't value, the serpent has already come to you, he's already visited you. Amen. And you have to crush his head. And you have to cut off his tail. What is his tail? His tail is his influence. He pulls you along. He pulls you along. Do your friends pull you along? Cut off that tail. Cut off that tail. What am I saying to you? I'm saying you tolerate. That's why the influence of the enemy easily can carry us. Because we tolerate. What does the Bible say? You easily tolerate. You tolerate. You mustn't be too tolerant. Amen. We are tolerant. We are tolerant with people who we know that we are helping. Not with people who are at our level. And definitely not with people who want to influence us. Amen. At that level, we are not tolerant. The Bible says we do not judge those who are outside. Amen. But if there is someone who influences you, and then they bring something, no toleration here. You must not become tolerant. You must not become tolerant with the serpent. Don't play when he's around. Sometimes you see, this is not the same way of thinking of faith that I was sharing with the man of God when he was preaching that other day. Amen. This is another way of looking at things. This is another way of looking at things. This is becoming complicated. Is my logic taking over? serpent has come here somewhere. Seven heads, intelligent, amen. Can even use your logic. You have to crush his head. Amen. That means you have to surrender your head. But doesn't the Bible say that we have died in Christ? Means you've died to our thoughts too. Amen. You have died to our thoughts too, so that Christ, his mind can live in us. Are you understanding me? Did you find your brother? Galatians 3 verse 15. No, but I wanted the one in Galatians. Okay. I'm telling you about the serpent because he's the one who stops that flow that Jesus was promising to you. Amen. You need to overcome what takes you out of that flow. The mind of Christ is, it's here. Jesus is saying, here, receive. But there is something contradicting. Amen. There is something arguing. Amen. With that faith that you had at first. Bible says, don't let go of the faith that you had at first. Amen. Don't let go of the faith you had at first. So, the mind of Christ is there, but there is something else. So, the flow of God, the flow of the Spirit of God, it flows through that trust. It flows through that value that we give to his mind, to what he says. Yes. Amen. We hear from him. We want to know what is his mind. What is his mind? We want to know what is his mind. His mind can be one word. It's not be many things. What did the centurion say? He said, speak one word. Just speak one word. And the problem is going to be solved. You don't have to explain the problem away. We just need the mind of Christ. We need his word. Amen. We need his word. But when his word comes, his word needs to dwell in us. It needs to live in us. We need to be attached. That's what Evangelist Madeleine taught us on Tuesday. Amen. We need to keep attached to the word. So we understand that the problem or the enemy of the scripture, it's the serpent. That scripture, what scripture am I talking about? I'm talking about the one that says, if anyone believes in me, rivers of living water will flow from within them. Amen. Let me give you another example. The Israelites. They were supposed to enter into Canaan, which is the land of their promises. Amen. As they are on their way, they are in a desert. So when they're in a desert, what do they begin to do? What do they begin to do? They begin to complain. This is not good. Why did you bring us here? This is not good. Bad. This is bad. Bad. Amen. Hallelujah. Is God leading someone here to their promises? Is God leading someone here to their promises? I can see we have to kick some serpent out of here. Amen. Amen. He is. He's leading you. He's leading you. Let's read a scripture verse that you can understand that he's leading you into your promises. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. So, this is what the Bible says. Hebrews chapter 4. Okay, let's read from verse 7. It says, this is shown by the fact that God sets another day, which is called today. Many years later, he spoke of it through David in the scripture already quoted. If you hear God's voice today, do not harden your hearts. Hallelujah. If Joshua had given the people the rest that God had promised, God would not have spoken later about another day. As it is, however, there still remains for God's people a rest like God's resting on the seventh day. For those that receive that rest which God promised will rest from their own work, just as God rested from His. Let us then do our best to receive that rest, so that no one will fail as they did because of their lack of faith. Amen. Amen. Your promises is there. It's called, in this scripture, it's called the rest of God. It's called the rest. It's where you rest from your own works. Hallelujah. This is the same thing as Jesus who said, those who believe in me, streams of living water will flow from within them. Why is it the same thing? I say it is the same thing because what is the rest from your own works? Does that mean I will get a good bed and I will have a holiday? No! Hallelujah! Actually, you will work harder than you've ever worked before. Amen. But there's going to be a power working from within you. There's going to be a flow of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. There's going to be a flow of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. There's going to be a flow of the Holy Spirit. That is the rest. That is the promise. What did Peter preach? Peter preached, believe in Jesus and you'll be saved, and you will give the Holy Spirit as He has promised. Hallelujah. What is your Canaan? Yes, there are many things in that Canaan. There is good life in that Canaan. Yes. But the core thing is that the Holy Spirit is going to be flowing within you. Amen. You will be working by His power. You will be understanding by His help. Amen. You are going to be praying with God. You are going to be speaking with God. That is the promise. That is Canaan. Hallelujah. And with God, you can do wonderful things. With God, you know, God is wonderful. There's many things that I can tell you about working with God or when you are with God. Because the Bible says that you will live in houses you didn't build. Hallelujah. Your children will come to you, but you didn't labor for them. Hallelujah. Many things happen. God gives rest. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. God makes things to work. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. God will work. Hallelujah. Amen. You will work in your life. That is your rest. That is the promise. But what must we do to enter? What does the Bible say? The Bible says, if they can hear God's voice, do not harden your heart. Amen. Today, if you hear His voice, don't harden your heart. What caused the Israelites to harden their heart? It was the fear of the giants in the land they were promised. In other words, it's not easy to live by the Spirit. It's not easy to live your calling. It looks too much for you. It looks too much for you. It's not easy for you to live this life of God, but that's looking at yourself. Yes, there can be giants, but go and conquer those giants. Amen. Go and conquer those giants. Believe in His voice. Let His voice be working in you. Let Him lead you in prayer. Amen. Let Him lead you in prayer. Sometimes we want to make our own prayer. But if God is giving you a prayer, let Him lead you in prayer. Trust Him. Amen. 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 Are you understanding me? Are you understanding me? We need to work with God. We need to work with the Spirit of God. We need Him to work with us. But for Him to work with us, we need to deal with the serpent. And what does the serpent do? The serpent causes a disconnection between us and God. It causes a breach, a break of trust. Amen. It takes our ears. It takes our ears out of the voice of God, and it puts it somewhere else. Maybe the problem, maybe someone else's voice, maybe, you know, maybe your thoughts. You understand? That's what the serpent does. The serpent takes your ears somewhere else. The Bible says the people's ears will itch for what they want to hear. No, I don't want to hear what I want to hear. Amen. Amen. I need the voice of God. I need the mind of Christ. Amen. 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 Fear is a problem. They were afraid before those giants. And they began to harden their hearts. In other words, they couldn't consider the word of God. It's not that the word of God has not been preached to you. Amen. Amen. No, you have heard words preaching to you. Amen. You have heard words that even you know they are relevant. They speak, but you can't find yourself considering them. Actually, a weight comes over your mind. It's like a weight, and it's like you can't see with this word anymore. You know, when you're in that service, you're like, you could see with this word, but now it's like, does this word apply here? You know, you can't take into consideration His word anymore. That's the serpent. And you understand that? Amen. That's the serpent. Amen. Amen. So do you understand how that is disconnecting you? That's taking away your revival. It takes away your revival. It takes away your revival. Do you understand? Amen. It takes away your revival. So we need to be in a place where we say, no, I need the mind of Christ. I need the mind of Christ. I need the mind of Christ. I don't want to run up and down. I don't want to get stressed and fretted. The Bible says, when you see the wicked do well, but you don't do well, there's a fretting. There's even can be an anger. Amen. Where there are issues in you, mind of God doesn't sit anymore. Amen. Doesn't sit anymore. So we want to deal with those things. We want to deal with those things. Amen. Because what we want to be able to move with the Holy Spirit. We want to go into our rest. We want to be firm in our faith. Amen. Hey. Have you experienced this one? It's like you can't even remember what they told you. Not because you can't remember. Not because you can't remember, but because there's a weight in your mind. Maybe caused by fear or by an issue or by something touching your heart. You can't even remember. Amen. Not because you're not intelligent to remember, not because your memory can't hold it, it can't hold it, but there's something weighing down your mind. Amen. We need to cut him off. Yes. We need to cut him off. Yes. We need to cut him off. Yes. So that we can have the mind of Christ. And then we will keep alive. Yes. I like the scripture that says in Psalm 24. It says, lift up your heads, O you gates. And see the King of glory. Mighty in battle. Let him come in. Let him come in. Let him come into your situation. Let him come into your mind and your heart. Amen. We need to lift up our heads. What was sitting on your head? Amen. Something has been weighing down your head. We need to remove it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We need to remove it in Jesus' name. So we can have his mind. With his mind, we are going to live. We're going to grow. The Bible says that blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Hallelujah. But meditates on the word of God, the law of God, the ways of God. Amen.
Amen.
And his delight is in it. Amen. We are not doing it only with our minds. We are doing it with our heart. When the serpent comes, he can cause a bitterness. Whether through something or another, not something or another, somewhere. And when you come to God, you can't come with that thing. And it's like, you know, your heart, it's been touched something. Amen. We are going to pray for the healing of hearts. We are going to pray for the healing of minds. We are going to lift off the burden. Hallelujah. Because the anointing, it breaks the yoke. Breaks the yoke. These living waters. Okay. I'm just going to finish with this word. I've already told you how Adam and Eve, how did they lose their revival? It was because part of the mind, amen, was devalued. And they lost the conviction that if I eat this, I will die. Amen. If I eat this, I will die. There are some things the world has been convinced, has been taking away your conviction. If you eat it, you will die. If you eat it, you will die. The world was playing with your conviction. If you eat it, you will die. Hallelujah. Vomit it. Vomit it! I believe that was for some people. Amen. The men of God bring us the mind of Christ. Your leaders bring you the mind of Christ. Let me tell you something. Those of you who are sheep, say amen.
Amen.
Do you know that your leaders have a responsibility to bring you the mind of Christ that God is depositing in the church? Leaders, do you hear that it's one of your main works? Actually, you are consecrated for that. To pray for those that you lead and to speak to them the mind of Christ that he's giving to the church. Amen. So sheep, you have to look at that voice differently. My sheep know my voice. Amen. Where the sheep doesn't take into consideration the voice of the shepherd, what are they going to do? The Bible says, we all like sheep, we have gone astray. And what does astray mean? It means lost. And lost is equivalent to death. Amen. Amen. Do you see where the serpent can catch us? It's when you can lose a vision of the one who must give you that mind of Christ. It's not for nothing that the mind of Christ is sitting in the head. Christ is the head. Do you agree? But now who is the head of your soul? The one who God established as head of that soul. Do you understand? I'm teaching you to begin to pick up where you can pick up the mind of Christ. Amen. You can pick up the mind of Christ by those who are responsible. Leaders are hearing me. Amen. You're responsible. You're responsible. To give the mind of Christ. Amen. When you give the mind of Christ, the sheep, what is your responsibility? Have a good vision of the shepherd. Amen. Now the shepherd, the serpent, he is the biggest enemy of the shepherd. Why he likes to strike the shepherd, but we're going to talk about that one. But the serpent, he likes to devalue the words of the shepherd. Let me tell you something, sheep. God is with your shepherds. things that you can take for granted can give you life. Amen. You have to pick up. Where is God here? In here. No, I can see God here. You have to begin to wake up. Where you discover that, no. This is not coming from the person themselves. This is coming from where they have been sent. Let me give you a good understanding, right? Jesus says, as the Father sent me, now I'm sending you. Amen. What do the apostles do? The apostles, what did Apostle Paul say? He said, appoint faithful and trustworthy people who will also give the mind of Christ to others, who will give the teaching the same one. Amen. So what does it mean? It means that the apostles also sent people. The apostles also established people. Do you understand that? Who are going to carry the same mind as they had received in the first place that was coming from Christ. So how can you pick up? Okay, no. You need to learn, because this is part of your faith. This is part of our faith as Christians. We understand that, okay, I need to pick up. I told you already about how to pick up the mind of Christ directly. But there's also indirectly. It's through your leader. Amen. And you have to pick up. When is something coming from your leader that is just from them? Or when is it coming out of from where they have been sent? Hallelujah. Amen. When they are doing something based out of being sent, they are doing the mind of Christ. They can be telling you to come to church, but it can be coming from Christ himself. If they are doing it because Christ asked them. Do you understand? So if you disobey, then who are you disobeying? That's the truth. Amen. Amen. I'm saying that because the devil, the serpent, he likes to devalue or take away your conviction with regard to the mind of Christ. Amen. You can even see, yeah, this is what the church would want us to do. Amen. But you have another mind. You have another mind. Another mind. Do you understand that? You think different, or you have another something else. You know, yes, this is what we're going to be, this is what we're going to be doing. This is where we are. Okay, we are this, but me, I'm this. No. Amen. If we have that, you will see you won't pick up when God says, don't eat, and you'll go ahead and eat. Do you understand that? Or you will know that it will say, don't eat, but for you, you understand? You understand? God won't come there, you know, and in an audible voice say, do not eat. Although we can do that. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm saying this to you to help you. Leaders, you have a responsibility to get it right. The Bible says teachers will be judged more strictly. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. But also given more grace. Amen. Because we need to move by the head. The mind of Christ is not only there to give you a lot of knowledge. Knowledge puffs up. Love builds up. Love acts. Love does good. Love builds. Love makes progress. Love grows you. Love grows people around you. Love grows yourself. Hallelujah. The mind of Christ. My brain doesn't have to tell my hand, move at a trajectory of 270 degrees at a velocity of... No! It doesn't explain physics. Amen. Amen. They have their own signal system. They just know when the mind thinks like this, then I must do this. Amen. If your pastor says, let's go, I do this. I'm helping you through very simple examples. Very simple examples. But I want you to understand that the mind of Christ is not far away from you. That's what I'm teaching you. But the serpent has been making you to play with it. Amen? Okay. So what I'm trying to tell you is that the mind of Christ also is instructions. Isn't that what Adam and Eve had? Yes, they were inspired to have dominion, be fruitful and multiply. Hallelujah. But do not eat. Eat of these trees. Do not eat of this tree. Amen? So we can begin to understand that we have to be people who live by instruction. We need to be people who live by, connected to instruction. Amen. What is the principle that is leading you in you? Amen. What is it that's making you do what you do? What is it making you do what you do? What is it making you what you do? Is it what you see on TV? Is it the mind of Christ? Amen. Okay, I'm going to finish there. What I am convinced of is this. Anything that comes from above has the image of God, has the blessing of God, has the empowerment of God. But we need to value and see it and give ourselves to what comes from above. That one needs to be children of God. Amen. And we understand that the church is a downloading place. Church is an airport. It's a place of faith. It's an airport for God to bring things. But is the church ready to run with those things? If we can give ourselves those things, we're going to move with the Spirit. We are going to flow. Amen. 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 That's why no more individualism in church. Hallelujah. Amen. Come out of isolation. Amen. Come close to somebody. Come close to somebody and talk to them. Hallelujah. Amen. Okay. Just there. I'm just going to pray and then we'll make some prayers together in this place as we finish the service.
Lord, you